how do you bring mood into film? Obviously, dialogue and an actor like Aamir Khan or Shah Rukh Khan performing is the mood, basically, you would say, or the script which is there. But apart from that, all other elements, which is part of the filmmaking, has a huge contribution into bringing that mood into the film. When a script is being narrated to me, my thinking is how I can make the audience feel what the director is trying to say. So, what are the elements which I can put into my frame or into my working atmosphere, which will help the audience who is sitting in the theatre feel that scene far better than the way it is narrated probably. So, I have to go beyond the director, not just technical knowledge, but in terms of aesthetically, you have seen Jodi Gaddaar, like, I mean, I will start with that probably. Now, we had the sequence of the train sequence for a long time in the script. I am wondering how to shoot it, like, I am still not getting an idea of like how to, because there is no dialogue in that scene. It is just shots and this guy gets killed and dumped into the other track where he dies. I was standing at the end of the compartment where you can see the next compartment through the vestibule which was open, you could see the next compartment. The other compartment keeps moving like that. Okay, I wanted to get that feeling to the audience, like this is what is happening, you know, and that has to disturb you, that pace has to disturb you, that sound has to disturb you, that movement has to disturb you. Now, I know that like if I put a camera inside a train, whether it is moving or whatever it is, put it in front of the thing, because the camera is also moving, the person is also moving, it will get static. It is a relative movement, there is nothing, zero is the relative movement. So, you do not get that feeling. So, what I made was make a contraption where I can hang the camera. Made two A structures connected on top with a rod and with a square below. And from the rod on top, I hung a cheese plate. Hung the cheese plate with bungee cords. So, because on the bungee cord, when you put the camera, the camera at times is like this, you know, or goes like this. So, I had to balance it. So, I used lot of small bungee cords here and there. I made another contraption below the low base. I made another plate like that, same square plate. And in between with two rods and four rods, I put multiple tension springs into that. So, it bounces like that, the thing. So, if I hit it and leave it, like it will keep moving like that. Now, this whole exercise was basically so that I get this moment. Because one big issue we had was the toilet. I found where the vestibule ends, the corridor ends and the toilet wall. You take a right turn and then go across like that. So, I said four screws here. So, I went inside the toilet and I found another four screws there also. It is connected. So, this plate opened up, there is a structure and there is another plate on that side. You open both legs, you can see the toilet. That is superb. So, I said, be careful with the railway officials, nobody should come this side, we will finish the scene. So, I got the camera again on that, there where the thing is placed, we put it there and put a small kind of a thing, kind of wooden piece somewhere we got and we put it on a cutter stand and put it right in front of the, just below the camera so that Neil can place the dabba, the bottle and all that, you know, so that it is right in front of my camera. And we ended up in Bombay with half the scene shot. We still have to shoot the rest of the scene. So, we managed to get one more day of the train, but we can't get a train. We don't have the money to have a train. So, we got a bogie. One compartment we got in the yard. So, we went to the yard. It's a static thing somewhere outskirts. There's nothing around. We had to walk half a kilometer and then reach there. And then we set up everything and I put my this thing. So, you have no clue whether that the train is running. Even now you see the scene, you will not be able to tell me which is static and which is moving train. Even the guy when he is being thrown out through the thing, I had a blue screen behind, for a plate to be pasted in the post of a passing train. Then I put another track outside, normal apna film wala track, put a 5 kW light and put it into this guy's face, and it made the light travel outside so that it looks like a train passing. So you dump the body and then this light is passing and pasted a plate of that outside. The movement was incorporated everywhere, even when the train was static. Now why I'm talking about it is, one aspect of movement gave so much of energy to the scene. With a lot of darkness which is incorporated within the frame with the lighting, just blue light, very strong blue light which is put into that, you know, that is the way the corridor is lit from the very beginning. And I made sure that in my frame there is something in the foreground which is always there, so that when I am moving like this, you know, there is a movement which is accentuated within the frame when you see that. So as a reference, and it disturbs you. One more scene I will tell you from Gaddaar. That is the bank opposite of this, the card place where they used to have their business. So it's a static frame actually, there's nothing which is happening in the frame. He's there and this guy is talking, and like, I mean, who's the guy? Only two of us are left. We just put that scene because this will bother the audience a lot, like whether Sadhul didn't think about it at all or not. I wanted to do something about it. So the whole space of that card room was a house actually. We were shooting in a house, and I had designed that in such a way that, like, I told the art department to get me Chinese tubes, auto rickshaw mein use hota hai na, like, I mean, the colored ones, the very dirty yellow kind of a tube lights which is used, because everybody will be sitting. So my frame will be mostly there, so I need a light source which is disturbing my frame within my frame where I am shooting it. So there's no point in having it there. So I made a pelmet made, and within the pelmet I put these cheap tubes. So it's a completely off color from what we use in filmmaking normally. I started switching off lights one after the other. One was this whole pelmet light which tuck karke went off. Then there is a shutter being pulled down, like the whole thing gets dark now. It was a lit place which within the whole dialogue sequence it became dark, and it's just these two guys sitting looking at each other. I don't have a shutter, I don't have a door there, none of these things are there. So this is all put light and made cutters and all that to close them, and add a sound effects later, like crack, like, I mean, the door is being closed. Somebody is moving in the background. You have seen in the beginning, there is a person moving. I wanted to get the feeling of that the place is being shut down. And the last one was the shutter. The shutter is just a sound, and I had a light which closed like that. So this was an entire scene which was played with thinking about the soundtrack in the post, which will give the impact, and a lights were being placed to give that feeling. So there, if I had tried to use movement in the first sequence in the train as my main element of creating a scene's energy, here it was a play of light which was used as the main element of creating energy.
इधर देखना, क्या मतलब क्या तेरा? मैंने मारा उसको?
मैं थोड़ी ना वो कह रहा हूँ.
तो क्या कह रहे तू?
फिर कौन हो सकता है?
मेरे को क्या मालूम यार, मेरे को मालूम पड़े तो मैं उधर ही. मेरे को नहीं चाहिए यार उसका क्लब, नहीं चाहिए मेरे को. मेरे को बहुत अजीब लग रहा है वो, नहीं है मेरे को बहुत अजीब लग रहा है.
What kind of a role are you seeking? Because we would presume that even to like there's an exciting script, to turn that into an image requires doing, no?
No, precisely what the two sequences I showed you could have been shot like that. I didn't have to go great lengths to figure out a mechanism and a contraption and shoot it with that, or even the last sequence of changing of the lights and all is an effort, or thinking is an effort as such, like more than doing it. Now this is what I enjoy, and I do get involved in the script as such, like, I mean, what are you talking about a particular point of time, you know, why are you talking about that aspect, you know. So the emotional aspect is something which I am trying to say. See, I want to work as a storyteller, not as a technician. I hate the term technician actually. It's about having it in your mind what you want, then get it from wherever where you can get it. That is cinematography all about it. Like, I mean, this aspect only a cinematographer can think about it, like not anyone else, because changing a space from one space to another space, a cinematographer can think about like how do you want to see that space. So my work starts from creating an image in my mind first of all. What is that I see in my mind? That is what the audience will see ultimately. I never read script. I hate reading scripts, so I insist on a narration. So I sit with Raju and a couple of people and all these directors, I insist on a narration. And I keep sitting on narrations. When they narrate it to an actor or in a bigger group, I keep sitting there. I want the film which he wants to make, not that when I read a script, I have my own film in my mind. That creates more fights. So I want to take it from there. So I always insist on narrations.
I was also saying, just like in Lage Raho Munnabhai, there are sequences. Typically what the audience understands by cinematography and the cinematographer's contribution, where Gandhi appears in the library and there is a backlight and all that. Supposing you were allowed to intervene, how would you do it differently?
This was my interpretation actually. Now this particular thing of him appearing, I don't know how many libraries we went and we were not happy with anything. Finally we found a place where we said we will put up a set of the library. Now having a set is a huge business. Library means how many books can I get? So we said we will do that and we went and saw the place and we were going back to the office. So we saw a board on the side, some granthalaya karke. Let's see this. We stopped there, we went inside and that was this place. It's a forgotten library, it's some Parsi library where I don't think anybody has stepped in that place. You know, like it's dusty, it's so many books strewn all over. We then, it was difficult to get permission. They said, no, we don't give it for shooting and all that. Like then a lot of pulling and all that, like finally we managed to get the permission, change the tube lights, we put those kind of lamps into that and made lot of Bapu pictures of this guy and he as Bapu then pasted, put all that there and we shot there for 4-5 days in the night. I wanted it to be real at one point. At the same time it has to have that surrealistic aspect of like, I mean, a guy coming out of that. So he, I wanted to him to appear from nowhere, not that he comes out of a wall. So how do you make him come like that? Because if you just paste him there, it will look like a gimmick. This place finally, it was damn difficult to push up that thing. There was no space to give that shaft of light to come in. I had this didn't have too high a ceiling. So I managed to get mirrors on the side and put lights on the other side or something and pushed it there so that I get that sharpness into the image. And had smoke filled up. Now when you fill up smoke, you see the curls of the smoke which is going. So I had three people with hand fans, I mean fans at three strategic places, and there was one guy who kept instructing them where to go, go right, go left and all that, so that you get this shaft correct. This is before digital effects came into cinema in a big way. Today I may not bother about that much.
I'll correct it in the post.
A lot of things I can add in the post. Those days we couldn't do that, so we had to create it exactly.
Munna,
kon?
Mohandas Karamchand Gandhi.
Dekho uncle, 3 nights se apun soela nahi. Khali pili dimag kharab kiya na to.
To khali pili kya karoge?
Umar ka lihaz kar raha hu uncle. Padhai karne de, nahi to.
Nahi to kya karoge? Maroge? तुम दाएं गाल पे मारोगे तो मैं बायां गाल आगे कर दूंगा प्रोफेसर साहब.
What happens when cinematographers turn directors? Like Govind Nihalani was a successful director. Santosh Shivan has also made interesting films.
Correct.
And sometimes they actually have other cameramen
shooting for them.
Films and they are not shooting their films.
Yeah, I've been thinking about directing a film at some point. Probably it's there in the mind, back of my mind, but I'm still scared. Direction is not the aspect which scares me. The rest of it. It's the thing which scares you. It's a painful field out there. You're battling with all kinds of animals from dinosaurs onwards. You know, most of them are dinosaurs. So that is the problem which is an issue. Now, coming to cinematographers becoming directors, one issue which I have noticed in most of the places, you start falling in love with your image. You start falling in love with your shot which you have taken. So you want that shots to be there in the film, whatever happens, you know. So when you direct, your power is more to put that shot. I mean, now whatever I shoot, even if you like it, Raju cuts it off and again, it's not there, you know, I can't do anything about it. But that is not the case when you're directing, you start putting them. I have seen good films which are done by DOPs. It's just, I can see it is a love for that image, he has kept that shot there. he should have removed it, that film would have been far superior. That way, it is much better that another DP shoots it. So, as in Raju is what I said, like so much of into editing.
But he edits his own films.
He edits his own film, so that editing comes into his direction also. I'll tell you one simple example, like in Lage Raho Munnabhai, there was this one sequence where Sanjay Dutt slaps circuit in the Dhobi Ghat thing. So, when I devised the breakdown, I wanted a transition happening in that from night to day. So, what I did was, I had framed in such a way that you don't see the light from outside. When you tilt down, you see the exterior through the slats. So, you realize that the time has passed and the camera pans and you find Sanjay Dutt sitting in one side and crying. When I saw the edit, he had removed this top portion. He had removed that whole tilt down portion completely. Now, he had cut it directly onto Sanjay Dutt sitting and crying. I said, this looks like he walked into the house and he is sitting and crying. Once you remove that transition from there, it looks like it is happening in the same night. You may realize that later, but the impact is gone. So, I had to convince him, then still very great difficulty he put that shot back. Lot of times he knows the pacing so well. That is the beauty of his films actually. You don't get bored even for a second, his films are gone somewhere else.
Why mood kyun kharab karta bhai? Jaane do na abhi. भाई मैं समझाएगा, मैं भाभी को समझाएगा, कोई टेंशन नहीं भाई, आप फिकर रहो, मैं सुबह क्या समझाएगा उसे, क्या समझाएगा उसे, क्या पूरे एक भाई है, ये समझाएगा, एक काम भी ठीक से नहीं कर सकता साला।
रघुपति राघव राजा राम पतित पावन सीता राम.
This is another sequence which again was a challenge when we started with the script. That was the climax in Three Idiots. If you look at the number of locations within this scene, that too many. Now when it came to raining, that became a problem for me. So, you have to have rain in all these places, which means when we shoot the hostel in the beginning, that was shot at IIM Bangalore, where we had shot the entire hostel sequence together. As you know, hostel rooms are very small, where you can't shoot. So, we were wondering how to do that. We wanted the ambience outside. When you look through outside, you wanted to see the hostel. So, you cannot put that in a studio complex. I had to think about a way of having rain everywhere. Now, it's not possible to see rain every place. So, what do you do with rain? So, I incorporated lightning into that aspect. So, many a places, I don't have rain happening in my frame. I have lightning happening, and in the soundtrack, you have rain running. So, we had two sets in Film City. One was outside where we made a huge tank, which was around 100 by 60 or something was the size of the water tank. And the water tank had got pillars and part of the IAM structure was erected as a single point of view, meaning from only one side it will look correct. We don't have finish on all the sides. Many a times we have a problem in lighting because to see water you have to backlight, otherwise you can't see water. When you backlight, the water becomes too bright at times where you can't see the actor. Then I realized there is a huge risk of electrocution in this whole thing because there is so much water all over. If any of the socket or any point wire is leaking, then it's a dangerous thing. So I told the production I need underwater cables to light up the space. I went through a security drill before the shoot with everybody. The entire unit was called in and I told them about the problem of shooting in this kind of a set because I said like one of my lighting guy, an electrician would check the waters before anybody gets into the water. So, all this was followed. We have been shooting lightning for last many decades in Indian cinema. What we use is like two arcs, carbon arcs, which you use and do this, you know, so you get a light. Now, imagine that space where this 100 feet of water body, 100 by 60 of water body, and there are so many structures and all, this one chitku thing is not going to help, you know, like it is not even going to be seen. So, I need a lightning which is spanning around 150 feet from my camera and from one unidirectional it has to come, it has to go. I got a mechanism which was on the HMI light, it is a shutter. Which opens like that and closes, lures basically. So, it opens and closes like that. So, you can open it and close it like as fast as you can with 5 4K HMIs were lined up on 25 feet rostrums. and I got guys on it. Now, the worst of the problems, how do you sync it? Because all of them has to come at the same fraction of a second. Now that cannot be done. Like each one will, movement will be different. So we had walkie-talkies lined up on a separate line altogether, and there was one guy, one of my assistants was in charge of that, and he will tell you 1, 2, 3. Three pe you have to strike. Now whether you should strike three ka T pe strike karna hai ki E pe strike karna hai, H pe strike karna hai. This is a problem. So we had to do that many times, again and again and again and again, and then kind of managed to use that. The scene goes through 4 or 5 lighting conditions for me. The first, when they bring that girl into the TT room and put her on the TT, they switch on the light and all that, like they put her onto the TT room. Now at one point, the light goes off. It is pitch darkness. It's very easy to write darkness, but how do I see darkness? I have to show. You can't switch off everything, you know. So I have to create darkness on screen. Now that darkness, there are a lot of things happening, like he goes and gets the vacuum cleaner in between, and you know, waking up people, and somebody is getting batteries and all that. They come back with torches now. Now that is the second layer of my lighting. It's happening with torches. Finally, they switch on one light, just the light which is above the TT table. That's my third layer. You have one light and the rest of is dark, supposedly dark. After the delivery, Rancho decides to pick up his bag and he is walking out into a space where it's dawn. Actually, the sun hasn't come up, it's very early morning, dawn. So that's a different space of lighting. And he comes and Baman follows him to the point, and that whole exchange is happening. When that pen exchange is happening, that is actually the sunrise point. Like, I mean, the sun rises there, and then we cut to the thing.
You were wrong! You were wrong! You cannot be right all the time! You understand?
Yes, sir.
You bought the important invention, though. You understand?
Yes, sir.
My director ne kaha tha ki jab koi extraordinary student hai
chata
good study exam se pass ho ke yahan se nikal jao.
This is around 4 or 5 lighting scenarios. Each one is different for me. And this whole thing, for me to achieve, it has to be within a set. If it's in a real space, I will not be achieve it, because even darkness is created with around 200 lights. Without that, I cannot create darkness.
Oh, please tell these guys, because they, in video, because they can
see. You cut down the aperture, yeah, and yeah, you can do it. That's not darkness.
Darkness is really, you can't see anything. You can't.
Darkness is created. It's a feeling of darkness which you have, but you have to see everything. At the same time, you have to feel that it is dark and there's nothing is on. When the light goes off, I had placed the lightning in such a way that it reflects from the floor. So floor is full of water. So actually it is a light full beam which is coming into the lens, so it blinds it, and then the darkness coming, so you believe the darkness more.
All your light arrangements are parallelly there.
Yeah.
And you just switch on and switch off.
Yeah.
Which means you are actually doing four sets of lighting. And shooting with 4 sets of lighting,
yeah,
already done. So
yeah,
that much more of lights.
That much more of lights. See, that scene of that sunrise happening, it took, I think, more than a day for us to shoot.
More than a day.
Yeah. So how can you shoot in real sunrise? Sunrise happens like that. Khatam ho gaya.
The only time you actually see reflection is when the sun comes up.
Yeah,
otherwise, you don't see any reflection.
Sun, I was using the reflections and all,
yeah,
that. Like it has to get into a celebration thing. That is the idea of having sun coming up there. So that's a that was a difficult thing, because every pillar should get the same kind of shadow. It can't change. So if you put one light, only one pillar will get that. The rest of the one will be backlight for those or front light for those. So I had to put light. Each pillar has to be separate light, and then that has to be cut off from the rest of the world. And then each sunlight which is coming in would change the shadow light also. What you see in the shadow intensity also will change. So that has to be separate. So these all has to go into dimmers and then systematically switched on and fade in and you know all that. Amir and this guy at Boman are standing like this. Now to have Amir shot like this, I have no backdrop. That's my lights. So I have to find another backdrop for Amir, which has to look exactly like. So
how much is the director in this case involved in?
Quite a lot. Not in the designing aspect of it. That's my job. Mm. I do it. But it's his thinky like, let's have the pen giving at the early morning. Mm. Because that's the climax. I mean, yeah. Though it happens, it's a flashback climax and then coming back into the real climax. This is a pre-climax actually. And your climax is at the lay when they meet up. So it was written like that. But I wanted to push it to this scale. So that was the argument. I said a film of this scale cannot have a climax which is happening in a room. I said it has to be pushed to the maximum, then only that climax works for me, otherwise it's, you are taking the film down. It's a very tough thing to do storytelling and stay within your style. That's a tough thing. The best compliment I ever got was when Johnny Gaddaar was, the trial shows were happening, Mani Kaul had come to see the film. So the film got over and I came out. And I was waiting for Mani Kaul to come out and he came out and he waved at me and he left. He didn't say anything to me. So I thought, that's why he, you know, walked away. I thought like, why he didn't say anything? Like, I mean, then I got a call from him after an hour or so. I mean, I got a call from him and he said like, I couldn't speak to you because he had a back problem. He said sitting for 3 hours had screwed up my back. So I had to leave. So I left. Now I came home. I have rested. That's why I'm calling back. He said it's a wonderful work. One interesting thing which you did was like he had liked my Lage Raho work. He had told me that once. He said like they are so different from one to the other. What was needed there, you have done that. Here it's a different storytelling which you have done that. The first time I'm seeing storytelling in cinematography.
Some people only work with European DOPs.
Yeah.
Why is that? Now what is it that in terms of style, is there some difference in terms of style?
They may be looking at things in a different way and definitely European sensibility is different, Hollywood sensibility is Indian sensibility is different. Now when you introduce that sensibility into our cinema, you may come up with a different thing altogether.
As two filmmakers, generally how we see lighting is, you know, we don't have any big ambitious approach towards lighting. We just think, okay, everything should be visible in the camera and probably night effect or something like that. We never think of lighting as a extra tool which could help us enhance our mood. So how do we go about it?
I would say it's from the very beginning. That's what I said earlier. It is. What do? You find a location, go and put the camera. If there is not enough light, you add one more light and shoot. That's not lighting. You are not saying anything through your lighting. You, when you read the story, you have to have an image in your mind. What is the story? Where is this place? So it is the image which dictates you. That image comes from your script and your script discussion with your director and all that.
But is it equipment related?
It is not. It's idea related. It is not equipment related.
A lot of filmmakers these days are changing to DSLR.
Technology is a tool which you have to use. Coming to the DSLR, it is, see, I again would say it has to come from the script. For me, every decision comes from the script and the atmosphere which you are shooting. When I was shooting Ek Hasina Thi, I went and got a camera model called 2C. 2C is very old, which is outdated. People don't use 2Cs in the industry. So I found a good 2C, did a test on that. I got it down and I shot the entire scene with that. The reason for doing that was I wanted to shoot it like this on my hand, like you would shoot a DSLR today. Those days we didn't have all that. So what I did was like I got the 2C and I got a video adapter to the viewfinder. And I got a video out which was plugged into a small DV cam which I tied with a rope on top of the camera. What you would look through the viewfinder, I would get it on the viewfinder of the DV cam. Now why I went through this whole process was, one was it was a fight sequence, so I wanted to shoot it like this. So I can't have it with a 435 kind of a big film camera, I cannot do that like that. My movement will slow down automatically. When she is attacking me, I wanted to move like this. And at the same time, I want to see the frame, which if I am putting my viewfinder into my eye, I won't be able to move like that. So I wanted an output and I could see it. 70% of Agent Vinod is shot with a zoom lens. and on a monopod. I was using a 235, which is the lightest film camera you can get. I got that, then I got a monopod, the strongest monopod I searched on the net and I bought it. Now it doesn't go together because it's a still camera thing. And I made a plate and a mechanism which I can do tilt and down with a lock and all that. I got it made where I can dock a 235. I made this contraption which I can move. When I pan, it is not a pan like that. I pan like that. And every shot is different for me. Every take is different for me. Well, I keep zooming in and out and, you know, I kept doing that. So even I myself don't know what frame I am hitting in the end of a shot. Very tough.
One shot?
Yeah.
Huh?
One shot.
How can you do this in one shot? Lighting itself is complicated,
yeah,
no?
Yeah.
Because all of it.
It's going all over, all over.
So you have a steady cam?
Yeah, it's a steady cam. But still, I don't even have a song.
Oh, you don't know the song?
Nothing, yeah.
And then the song came in?
Song came after we shot.
Oh, so the song has been pasted,
yeah,
after you've shot?
Yeah. I had the beats, which I listened to the beats.
Okay.
What is the rhythm of the song? Whatever you paste it, probably it will work. That is not the issue. The issue is to do the choreography. Now, to do this, the trick is to have the in and outs correct.
So, would you like to comment on the collaboration that happens on the sets between a cinematographer and the sound guy?
Thanks to the combined education we had in Film Institute, actually. So one understands how sound works and, you know, things like that. Otherwise, it doesn't happen. You normally have both lapel and boom, which is the two booms will be there, and it's all multiplied in that sense. There are issues like my light is creating a sound, you know, some HMIs are, HMI dimmers are creating sound, or some LED or something, those kind of things which are done is creating sound. They decide where the generators are going to be placed, how far they will be placed. So all that is recorded much in advance. So you book those places. So they take from me like what are the areas I am going to cover, what is the blind spot. So which every location I have to tell them what is my blind spot.
As a cinematographer, day to day, what are the main challenges that you face and what makes you angry?
I was asking in one of my classes in the institute, like, what do you think is the best quality a DP should have? So they told me about knowledge about painting and, you know, having understanding of light, and different people came up with different things. I said the most important thing he should have is a big bladder, because you don't get time to take a leak. So that is the challenge, actually. When I land upon the set in the morning onwards, it is, I just can't get out. Something or the other, and I have to take decisions every moment. Somebody is asking me something which I have to give an answer, and I'm responsible for that answers. So I have to think about not just the aesthetics of it, the politics which is on the set, you know, all that I have to think and give answers. Because a set is run by a DP, actually. So he decides the pace of a shoot.
But why this cliche is that cameramen are very nasty to their people who are working under them?
No, I'm not like that. From very early period onwards, what I tried was, I tried to make my communication correct. I'm the first one who started using walkie-talkies on my set. I bought personally. I'm the first one started using laser pointers on my set. Because when you tell an assistant, ki like, wo cutter thoda right pe karo, there are 20 cutters moving, you know, normally, because everybody takes your word seriously. So you have to be very specific, like that cutter you want to change. So this is something which I started practicing very early, like be very specific. So when I am on a set, I brief much before to my team, like this is our plan, this is how we are going to do about it. So I don't have to shout at all.
That brings us to the end of this session.
Thank you.